I joined the Ministry of Defence pretty much straight from school in 1985, and the philosophy at the time was that they give you 2 or 3 years in a particular post and then they move you on. The idea was that you would do, say, a tour of duty in policy, tour of duty in finance, one in contracts, one in personnel, and they would try to encourage people to have a fairly broad base, then maybe specialise later in their career. So I'd done 2 or 3 different jobs, and then in 1990, after the Saddam Hussein invasion of Kuwait, I was seconded from Secretariat Air Staff, where I was doing a job where the duties included briefings for senior personnel visiting Air Force bases. I had some responsibilities to do with military aircraft accidents, but I was seconded out of that and into the Joint Operations Centre. I was working in a part of that called the Air Force Operations Room, dealing with real-time operational information to do with the build-up to, and then in 1991, the Gulf War itself, the first Gulf War. Yeah. Effectively, I was a briefer. I would get information. It would be to do with the RAF, so it would be bombing raids, any casualties or losses, battle damage assessment, etc., etc. And the key thing was the daily briefs for ministers and the service chiefs. And my job was to take raw data and to craft it into something succinct, accurate, that quickly gave those senior decision makers the information that they needed. While I was doing that job, certainly I think in the early part of 1991, the person that I was most directly working to said, "Look, I understand that before you were pulled out of your old job and seconded down here, you had expressed an interest in moving on from your old job." He said, "I may have a job coming up after the war." And that job was the UFO job.
Right.
So he said, "Would you be interested?" Because we had a fairly good working relationship. He said, "Would you be interested in taking that job up?" I think part of me felt that I had actually been looking for a move. So there was, at a certain extent, I was saying, I wanted to move anyway.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
To another part of me thought, the UFO job. What on earth is that all about? And I think I was so intrigued that we even had a UFO job, that for a number of reasons, and I probably now can't put my finger on the exact decision-making process, but to cut a long story short, I said yes. The offer did actually materialise, and then in the summer of 1991, I actually started work on the UFO project. I didn't really have a detailed picture of what working on the UFO project would involve. Mm-hmm. I knew that the bread and butter of that part of the job was effectively to research and investigate the UFO phenomenon, and the Ministry of Defence's party line, as it were, was that these things are investigated so that we can come to a judgment on whether any of the UFO sightings might suggest anything of any defence significance, mm-hmm. any, for example, a potential threat to the defence of the UK. But I didn't know much more than the standard policy and that I would be investigating UFOs. I didn't know really the mythology, the methodology of an investigation. I didn't know what sorts of cases I would come across. I certainly didn't know any of the history of the British government's involvement in this subject. Obviously, I'd gone for a chat about the job, but it's not until you actually start and that you have the traditional, and back then it was a 1 week handover where you actually sit alongside the previous incumbent, mm-hmm. and effectively shadow him for a week and then take over the following week. It wasn't until I was actually doing that, sitting at the desk, going through some of the old files, taking some calls, that I really began to get a flavour of what was involved. in a sense, that's good. I didn't really have any preconceived beliefs on the subject. I certainly had very little knowledge. I'd possibly come across Charles Berlitz's book on the Bermuda Triangle when I was a kid, which from recollection had a chapter on UFOs, but I was certainly not a buff or believer or whatever. Neither was I a complete hardened skeptic, thinking this is complete nonsense. So I went in there, in a sense, with an open mind, but frankly not expecting to find, shall we say, little green men. So that was my mindset. Of course, UFOs exist. I mean, because of, in its literal sense, a UFO is simply an unidentified flying object, and therefore, because people do see UFOs, there is a UFO phenomenon. Whatever one thinks lies behind it, and I'm sure we'll get onto that. So UFOs are seen and reported in their tens of thousands, and that's an undeniable fact. And some of the witnesses, as we'll discuss, include pilots, military officers, police, etc., etc. I think the question is, perhaps, does having a UFO project imply a belief, say, in something exotic, even extraterrestrial? The answer I'd like to give about this, if you'll forgive a little soundbite, is that there isn't a corporate belief in Martians, but there is a corporate belief in Russians. Now, it's interesting that the UFO phenomenon, obviously people have seen strange things in the sky throughout recorded human history, and I'm sure through unrecorded human history as well. The MOD's UFO project has its roots in something that happened in 1950, and I think it's interesting just for me to explain this, because I think it gives you the mindset behind why the MOD, and really why all governments that have dabbled in this subject, are involved. The then chief scientific advisor, the great radar scientist Sir Henry Tizard, Winston Churchill, after the war, had brought him back into government, and he was chief scientific advisor at the MOD, and he said that UFO reports were obviously being received from all around the world, and were, you know, obviously in the UK as well. He said, we ought not dismiss these reports without some form of proper scientific study. And that was about as far as his statement went, but it probably gives you the quickest and easiest answer into why governments and the military look at these things. We don't know what they are, but rather than just guessing or dismissing, common sense dictates, particularly if the reports suggest structured craft with speeds and manoeuvres going ahead of anything we've got, at least we should be taking a look at that. And that's what Sir Henry Tizard said, and indeed that's why, as a result of his initiative, the MOD set up something called the Flying Saucer Working Party. It's absolutely, it's the most marvellously named committee in the history of the civil service, I'm sure. And we've had a few odd ones. Interestingly, it's conclusions were fairly sceptical and reflect, to a fairly large extent, the government's position on the subject to this day. In other words, we believe most of these things can be explained as misidentifications of known objects or phenomena, as hoaxes or as psychological delusions of some sort. And we've seen no evidence to suggest that there's anything that makes the UFO subject worthy of any further study. We recommend a discontinuation of this research and investigation effort. The plug was pulled a matter of months later. The RAF found itself in the centre of a series of fairly high profile sightings where UFOs were being tracked on radar, being seen by pilots when their aircraft were scrambled to try and intercept these things. And the MOD was dragged, I think a little bit reluctantly, some would say kicking and screaming, back into the UFO subject, and has pretty much, until or fairly recently, had a UFO project of one way, shape or form to the present day,
yeah.
With the brief being fairly constant, research and investigate the phenomenon, see if there's evidence of a threat.
Yeah, defence significance, ultimately where it boils down.
Exactly. Is there anything of any defence significance?
Mm-hmm.
And I think the sceptics within the MOD, and it's important to say that this whole sceptic versus believer debate has taken place as much at the MOD and in government as it has anywhere else,
yeah.
Whether it's media, whether it's UFO researchers or anything. But the sceptical MOD line would be UFOs are of, quote, no defence significance. But again, there are plenty of senior politicians and military personnel who say, no, we believe that the UFO phenomenon is of extreme defence significance. Not yet too far into any operational business, but I think you can take it as a matter of public record that UFOs have been tracked on radar on numerous occasions, and there are plenty of documents at the National Archives, both in Britain, in America, and indeed I'm sure in all sorts of other countries, recording cases where precisely that has happened. UFOs have been tracked on radar. Yes, if the radar operators, the fighter controllers, then assess that radar return as being solid, and if it's not obviously using a transponder, so we can't actually identify it as an aircraft, yes, a judgment call will be made, and that judgment call may be scramble the aircraft, be they the ones kept on quick reaction alert, or be they any other fighter interceptors, and go and take a look. It happened very famously, for example, in Belgium in 1989, and particularly in 1990 on March 30th and 31st, when the Belgians tracked a UFO on radar. Two F-16 fighters were scrambled. They attempted to lock on to the UFO with their airborne radars, which they succeeded in doing. So the UFO was being simultaneously tracked by ground-based radars belonging to both the Belgian Air Force and indeed some radars which were integrated into the NATO network, and indeed, as I say, by the pilots themselves on their separate airborne radar. Every time they achieved lock-on, the UFO seemed to break the lock and be capable of evading the aircraft. They tried to and succeeded in reacquiring on a number of occasions, and this game, as it were, of cat and mouse played itself out in the Belgian skies for some considerable time. Observers on the ground, including a number of police, said that they could actually see and hear the aircraft, they could see the UFO,
yeah.
They could see this unfolding. And they said every time the aircraft looked as if they were getting close, the UFO seemed to be capable of moving away at great speeds. That's a fairly famous case, but there are many, many other cases, a lot of them in the 50s, where perhaps the Cold War and people's nervousness about Soviet aircraft probing our defences was at its height.
Yeah.
But plenty of cases on the public record, a number of pilots have spoken out quite publicly about being involved in these intercepts. So yes, these things do happen. I've spoken to civil pilots who've seen these sorts of things. Graham Shepherd,
yep,
was an interesting example, a senior British Airways captain who'd had two spectacular UFO sightings in 1967, which was of course a big year for UFO sightings all around the world, but particularly in America and Britain. I've spoken to military pilots who were involved in intercepts. I've spoken, interestingly, to military pilots who've seen UFOs who never reported it. And again, perhaps I'm sure we'll talk a little about numbers of reports and such like. But you know, these things go on. One of my most interesting conversations was actually with somebody at the RAF, Ballistic Missile Early Warning Centre, RAF Fylingdales, and he said, from time to time, he said, we see meteorites and fireballs on our space tracking radar. He said, they do speeds of about 17,000 miles an hour. Mm-hmm. And I said, simple question, I said, how do you know they're meteorites and fireballs? And he said, well, because they go very fast. So there was a sort of, well, what else could there be tone of voice? Mm-hmm. But that's interesting, because it goes to the heart of something which I feel quite strongly about. What's equally important in looking at the UFO phenomenon and the way in which the military respond to it, it's not just the equipment, i.e. your radar systems, be they space tracking radars or be they more conventional air traffic control or military radars. It's actually the training and the mindset of the people operating this. It's well known, and I can't go into obviously too much detail, but it's well known that, for example, you can use filter programs on radar to filter out anything that goes faster than a certain speed, lower than a certain speed, because all the time your radars are configured for what you're expecting to see, what you're actually looking for. Anything that doesn't conform can be filtered out by a computer program now, but the important thing is there's also a filter program up here. And I think people's minds sometimes say, well, that's interesting, I got an anomalous return on my radar system, but then it just faded away. Well, people know radar is not an exact science. You can get a false return because of temperature inversion. A flock of birds in some circumstances will give you a return, the flock dissipates, the return disappears. But it's all too easy, I think, for your belief system to kick in, and if it doesn't behave like a conventional aircraft, the filter program in your mind can filter it out. I wonder sometimes how many interesting UFO cases have been lost because of that mindset. Now, I'll do a boring statistical bit, but I'll give you, I'll make the point for a reason. Doing my job at the MOD, I got about 200 or 300 UFO reports each year. Now, of course, that was just in the UK. My brief was just national, not global. I wasn't, of course, the only person getting UFO reports. Some people would report to the local media. Some people would report to one of the civilian UFO groups. Well, the police or the military, we did have a national reporting system. Anyone who reported a UFO to a police station, to a military base, or to a civil airport, there was a standing operating procedure whereby those details should be recorded and the cases should be sent to the MOD for investigation. Now, having said that, it was clear to me that system was operating in a fairly patchy way. It needed beefing up. Some people had clearly lost the standard operating procedure, and I've spoken to some police forces who said, oh, we just treat these as hoax calls or crank calls, and I said, no, there's a procedure, you're supposed to record these and forward them to us. But the point is, there was a national reporting system, but as I say, some UFO reports go to the media, some go to the UFO groups. Most people won't actually report at all. Two reasons, fear of ridicule, and simply not understanding where to actually make a report. Who are you going to call? So you could figure that my 200 or 300 reports were obviously just the tip of the iceberg. And I've seen this for myself at even at UFO conferences where you know that you're drawing in enthusiasts and people who've got a natural interest. I've seen it done with a show of hands. How many people in the audience, the speakers will ask, have seen a UFO? Then the follow-up question is, how many of you made an official report, or indeed made a report to anyone?
Yeah.
Those people, keep your hands up. Everyone else who didn't report it, put your hands down. Most of the hands go down. We only study a very small part of the potentially available data. But here's the interesting thing. That happens as much with the military as anyone else. Even though the military should, and frankly do know full well, that there is a standard operating procedure and that they're mandated to make a report. I've spoken to pilots who've said to me, look, Nick, I've seen UFOs. And some pretty interesting sightings. One of them said to me, I'm a corpse, he said, look, I saw a UFO. It casually overtook my aircraft. It wasn't a light, it was a craft. I obviously can't go into huge details about prototype aircraft, but he was fairly sure it wasn't anything. Not one of ours.
Yeah.
But he said, I didn't report it. And I said, why not? He made a little joke. He said, I didn't want to be known as Flying Saucer Fred for the rest of my Air Force career. Now, yeah, if that mindset is prevalent in the military, when they know about the process of making official reports, how many other spectacular reports are there out there, both involving pilots, radar operators, or members of the public, that we just sadly never got to hear about at all? A lot, I would suggest. This particular one caught my eye. As you say, a flight of Tornado RAF jets had been casually overtaken by a UFO, which they described as a sort of delta or diamond-shaped craft with an unusual configuration of lights on it. There was some speculation that it was a stealth aircraft or some such object, but there was, for some reason or the other, and it's not really appropriate to speculate, there didn't seem to be much follow-up of the incident. So the MOD's file contains little other than the report from the pilots themselves. But knowing what we now know about the speed of a stealth and the configuration of lights, that explanation doesn't seem to fit. Some people have proposed that a potential satellite re-entry might explain the UFO sighting as well. But again, space junk re-enters the Earth's atmosphere a lot of the time. And I've spoken to a lot of scientists about this, and what you get is a sort of high-altitude firework display. You don't get what these RAF pilots reported, a solid structured craft actually coming from behind the aircraft, in front of the aircraft, and then accelerating away. So that didn't seem to fit either. Intriguingly, the date of the UFO sighting was 5th of November, so you know, some people said, well, maybe it was a big firework for our Gunfork celebrations, but that was obviously just a joke. No, this is just one of a number of cases involving military witnesses where, to this day, there is no satisfactory explanation for what's seen. It's a shame that there wasn't more follow-up, but you know, I think the UFO Project's files, and I'm sure the files indeed of Project Blue Book, are littered with intriguing cases like that, which perhaps weren't followed up as much as they should have been. Halfway through my tour of duty, in March of 1993, there was a major wave of UFO sightings over the United Kingdom, and indeed over other parts of Europe. I came into work on the 31st of March, and the phone was ringing. I picked it up. It was a police officer down in Devon. He explained to me how he and his colleague had seen a UFO, so of course I I took the details of the report and began to investigate. Pretty much as soon as I'd started that, the phone rang again, another UFO report came in. Again, another police officer. The reports came in thick and fast throughout the day, and indeed over the next few days, and it was soon clear that this was a major wave of UFO sightings, that because quite a lot of the sightings had happened at night, a lot of the witnesses were police officers on night patrol. Now, of course, there's no such thing as an infallible witness, but inevitably trained observers such as police officers, military personnel, pilots who will have an idea of what things look like in the sky, speeds, heights, distances. Inevitably, some witnesses are better than others. So it was interesting that there was a high proportion of police officers reporting this to me. The earliest UFO report came from, it was 30th of March 1993, and it was about 8:30 in the evening. That was from a, funnily enough, an off-duty police officer who was actually leading a troop of scouts out on outside activity. And he saw an object which he described as almost being like two Concorde aircraft stuck together. So a pretty massive craft. The interesting thing in all of this goes back to an interesting point about the under-reporting of UFOs. Sometimes when people say, how many UFOs were, how many reports do you have for that night? You might have one piece of paper on your desk that you treat as an individual report, but at the bottom there'd be a throwaway line, as for example there was with one of the police reports, and it said, I know from monitoring my radio that dozens of police colleagues throughout Devon and Cornwall saw the same thing. And interestingly, again, with this scout group, again, we didn't have individual reports from all the boys. So the number of people who'd actually seen this thing over a course of several hours, the last report was at about 2:40 in the morning on the 31st. So this UFO, whatever it was, had been operating over the UK for a period of several hours. The number of witnesses clearly ran into hundreds, but of course again, UFOs are majorly underreported. Now, the critically interesting point to me about this case, and it was something of a turning point. I think sometimes it's been said this is the case that turned me from skeptic to believer. I think that's an oversimplification, but it was certainly a case that had a profound effect on me and made me hopefully more open-minded to some of the more exotic possibilities. The UFO flew over two military bases, RAF Cosford and RAF Shawbury. It was seen by a patrol of Air Force police officers at the first base, and then it was seen by the meteorological officer at the second base. Now, this was a man with 8 years experience in the Air Force. As a Met officer, his job was looking into the sky. He was based at an Air Force station. He saw aircraft and helicopters on a frequent basis. So this is probably about as good an observer as you can get in terms of not the sort of person to misidentify. He described to me a vast triangular-shaped UFO moving slowly over the fields coming towards the base. He said there was a narrow beam of light firing from the craft. That beam of light was tracking from side to side, he said, as if the UFO was looking for something. He said there was a low-frequency humming sound coming from the UFO. And he said it was one of those unpleasant sounds that you could feel in your chest as well as hear. He likened it to standing in front of a bass speaker, that sort of effect. And as he was describing this to me when I interviewed him, he was clearly quite shaken up by this, and he said that this was unlike anything he'd ever seen before. And quite what I could tell this chap. And incidentally, he said that the UFO had been moving fairly slowly, 20 or 30 miles an hour. and then suddenly had shot away to the horizon, many, many times faster than a fast jet. And that's a consistent description from many witnesses in some of the most compelling of UFO cases. But here it was being relayed to me firsthand by an Air Force witness. What was I supposed to say to him? Sorry, it was just a weather balloon. Of course, I launched a full investigation. We checked all the usual sorts of activities that give rise to misidentifications. We, at any given time, have an idea of what's flying in our airspace. We look at flight paths. We look at the radar data. Of course, I ordered the tapes be impounded and sent to me at Ministry of Defence headquarters. We looked at those radar tapes. I worked with some specialist radar staffs in the Air Force. We looked at the data. There were some inconclusive readings that might have explained, or rather might have corroborated, some of the sightings. But radar is an inexact science. The particular radar head is one that was prone to picking up ground clutter, as I said, tall buildings under certain meteorological conditions. So the honest answer was, yes, there is something on the radar, but whether it's the UFO and we've tracked it or not, there's nothing you could really take to the bank. This went up the chain of command through my head of division to the assistant chief of the air staff, one of Britain's most senior military officers. He said, as often happened with the most interesting UFO cases, this was almost the catch-22. Because we'd done such a detailed investigation, the reply was, well, this is extremely interesting, but there is really nothing else that we can do by way of taking this forward. But noted with interest, object unexplained, case closed. Or rather, I say case closed, in effect, case like an unsolved murder, perhaps, forever open, but effectively unresolved. Whether we'll get what the police would call a cold case review, and whether we'll go back and reopen investigations, as I did from time to time with other cases, I don't know. One interesting postscript to this story is that I recently was heavily involved with and presented a program on British network television on one of the prime channels, devoting an hour to an investigative documentary about this case. Following the broadcast of that program, I received personally another 25 reports from witnesses who had seen this UFO, either on the night concerned or at some stage before and since, seen this same sort of vast triangular shaped craft, and had never previously come forward or reported to anyone. So there perhaps is some further work we can do. Whether we'll ever explain that case or not, I don't know. As ever, skeptics have tried to perhaps shoehorn one or two things into it. There was a re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere of a Russian rocket that night, but that occurred at a very precise time and would have given a sort of high-altitude fireworks display. And even the director of an observatory here in the UK has actually said he doesn't think, although he's sceptical about UFOs, he doesn't think, from what he knows about this case, that that could explain it. Or if it did, it could only explain a handful of the high altitude sightings, but many of the witnesses saw a vast triangular shaped metallic craft at low altitude. One of Britain's most compelling UFO cases, without a doubt.
I feel warm, strong, numb. I feel warm, strong, numb. Way too high up there to feel your hands reaching out for me. Invincible, no need to shift back.
Yes, I mean, to me, Rendlesham was always the most important case in the history of the British government's UFO project, and indeed I reopened the investigation into it to try and do, again, what a police officer would call a cold case review, to try and see, did we miss anything this time round? Is there new evidence that we can find on this? And yeah, it's a critically important case because it involved military witnesses, and it wasn't just a one-off, it happened over a series of nights. It's interesting, there's an interesting piece of psychology, as it were, that when people try, as they sometimes do, to downplay this this sighting, they refer to the fact that the official report is titled Unexplained Lights. When you actually read the official report that is entitled Unexplained Lights, it makes it fully clear that what we're dealing with was a landed metallic craft. And on the first night, lights in the forest were seen. The troll thought that maybe one of the aircraft from the two bases involved, RAF Bentwaters and RAF Woodbridge, twin bases under a unified command separated by Rendlesham Forest, they thought one of the aircraft had come down. They went out to investigate. They saw this landed metallic craft moving through the trees, touching down, flying off. One of the military personnel got close enough to touch the side of the thing. They sketched, or one of them sketched strange symbols on the side of this craft, on its hull, which he likened to Egyptian hieroglyphs. They do claim that they took photos of it as well, but that they were told, some of the United States Air Force witnesses, that, there was nothing on the film, it was just fog. Obviously, a lot of conspiracy theories have grown up as a result of that. The UFO came back on a subsequent night. This was December 1980. The deputy base commander, Lieutenant Colonel, as they say in the States, Charles Holt, had heard about these UFO sightings. He was at a function, and the door burst open, and a young airman ran up to him and said, "Sir, it's back." And Holt looked a bit confused and said for a moment, what's back? He said, "The UFO, sir, the UFO's back." So Holt threw together a team of people. He took some powerful generators, light generators called Lightalls, into the forest with him. And he took also a personal dictaphone on which he recorded his thoughts and observations as he and his team effectively tracked the UFO. And the interesting thing is, his words were that he went out to debunk this. In other words, he thought it was all stuff and nonsense, but he couldn't debunk the thing because he ended up becoming a witness to it as well. And I've heard the tape, you can hear the tension and fear even in their voices as the UFO approaches. At one stage, it's firing beams of light down at the military establishment. Clearly, whatever you think UFOs are, this has got to be of defence significance, it seems to me. And again, a hugely important part of the story of the Rendlesham incident is that when the landing site from the first night's activity was examined, they found three indentations in the ground where this thing had landed, perhaps on legs. And those indentations, when they were mapped, formed a triangle. So as if this thing had come down on a tripod-like device. And most interestingly of all, when they looked at the area and they ran a Geiger counter over it, they found that the radiation readings they recorded were significantly higher than background. And that quote comes from a Ministry of Defence assessment done by the Defence Intelligence Staff. And surprise, surprise, they peaked those radiation readings in those three indentations where the UFO had briefly landed. So, all sorts of interesting things. There are still many unanswered questions about the Rendlesham Forest incident. Many things, frankly, were mishandled. The initial investigation was not done as I would have carried it out. So far as I can tell, no cordon was established around the landing site to prevent cross-contamination. No detailed search with metal detectors was undertaken. No soil samples were taken. So in many ways, this was a mishandled investigation. An intriguing, unanswered question is the removal of certain items of evidence. We don't know what they are. It might be the photos. It might be other things that are not recorded in the files. But the Commander-in-Chief of the United States Air Force in Europe, General Gabriel, made an unscheduled visit, so far as we know, to Bentwaters Woodbridge after the event, immediately aftermath of the event, and recovered certain items, returned them to his headquarters in Ramstein, Germany. Now, the file on this, the Ministry of Defence file, makes very interesting reading because it says somewhat plaintively, maybe we could have a look at these items too. But again, there seemed to be no follow-up. So the trail, I won't say it's gone cold, because I know that a lot of people are aggressively using the Freedom of Information Act, both in America and in Britain. My view now is that I can't rule out an extraterrestrial explanation for some UFO sightings. My view is that the extraterrestrial hypothesis is a possible explanation for that, particularly when you look at craft which in terms of their speeds and manoeuvres go way beyond anything that we've got, including black projects. I can't rule out an extraterrestrial explanation for that. My view is that there is some intriguing evidence that would support such a hypothesis, but that there's no hard proof that could actually put the matter beyond debate. Well, I think with both UFO sightings and indeed with the alien abduction phenomenon, one could say that in a small number of cases, and I want to make that very clear, it's only a small number of cases, psychosis could I think be both the cause of the experience and indeed the result of it in different circumstances. It is unquestionable that there are some people whose mental illness will cause, say, delusions, and that with some mentally ill people, they will fixate on the UFO or abduction phenomenon, and they will see or describe their experiences or such like in that way. But none of this is meant to disparage the phenomenon. I think one could say that people with psychoses like that will fixate on all sorts of different things, often it's religion. So it doesn't come as any surprise that some people with psychoses would drift into the field of ufology. I think the other the flip side of that is almost more interesting. Could some sort of psychosis be the result of an experience, whatever that experience might be? And I think unquestionably the answer has to be yes. The obvious consequence, and I've seen it with some people, is clearly post-traumatic stress disorder, which whether somebody has had what believers might call a genuine encounter with, say, extraterrestrials, or whether the person simply believes that they have, perhaps because they've misidentified something, it's quite possible that that person could be profoundly affected by their experience, and the consequences of that might be post-traumatic stress disorder. It might actually go further and become some form of more serious psychological or psychiatric condition. Yes, certainly the theory that quote psychological delusions unquote might explain a number of these reports has been around for decades, and indeed the Ministry of Defence was seizing on that as a potential explanation for some of the UFO reports, certainly as early as 1951. Having said that, it's interesting. Yes, I mean, inevitably there will be a handful of people with psychological, psychiatric conditions, fantasists, whatever, who attach themselves to the UFO subject, who come to UFO researchers or to the media with stories that have no basis in anything other than perhaps some form of delusion. But it's interesting, particularly in relation to the abduction phenomenon. There have been a couple of scientific studies done on this in America by Susan Clancy and Richard McNally, and two that I want to mention briefly, but they're very important. The first one was really, and there have been two or three experiments in this, one of which was actually run in the UK by Professor Chris French. There have been attempts to look at a group of abductees and in a double-blind experiment to compare and contrast those abductees with a control group of non-abductees. Now, the first, I'll call this set of experiments because this has been done both in America and Britain, certainly suggest no evidence of any psychopathology in any of the abductees, and that's important in these double-blind experiments. So, if you'll forgive me for using an unscientific word, but these people are not mad. None of that necessarily means that the experience is real in the sense that some people might use that word, but certainly it tends to suggest that the abductees, or at least the ones that have been tested, really aren't suffering from any sort of psychological condition. The other experiment was equally interesting, and what was done was that, again, in double-blind conditions, the group of abductees were asked to relay their experiences. A control group of non-abductees was asked to relay similar experiences as if it had happened to them and imagine themselves suffering the trauma of it, both physical and psychological. Now, interestingly, these people were being monitored, and in the group of abductees and not the control group, they found physiological responses such as more rapid heart rate, increased perspiration from the abductees. Again, none of this proves that the experiences happened in a real physical sense, but it did suggest that these people weren't lying and that they genuinely believed that these experiences had happened. Belief is hugely important. Now, I don't think a belief can of itself generate an an experience, certainly not the sorts of physical experiences where we've got UFOs tracked on radar or other physical trace evidence, where a UFO has landed, where it's been photographed or such like. But belief is important in my opinion, not so much as the stimulus for an experience, but in the way in which we interpret experiences. Inevitably, I think, how we perceive something, that goes not just to UFOs and abduction experiences, but of course much wider. It really covers many, many things in our ordinary everyday lives. Belief, your beliefs, your knowledge, and your cultural background will play a part in how you perceive and interpret experiences. I think the example that I can give in relation to this is that imagine a scenario where somebody wakes suddenly and sees a shadowy figure at the foot of their bed. Now, if that person is particularly religious, they might perceive that experience. They might come to believe that what they've seen is an angel or a manifestation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. If that person was a ghost hunter, they might be thinking in terms of spirits. If that person was a ufologist, or had a knowledge of ufology, inevitably they might look at this in terms of aliens and alien abductions. Now, an interesting theory to follow that point up is, what if these experiences, whatever they are a little bit more amorphous than we might suspect? What if there is a phenomenon, but it is neither extraterrestrial nor religious nor any of these other explanations? It is amorphous, but it collapses into something more tangible when it interacts with the witness. In other words, it sort of takes something from the witness's knowledge and culture and belief system and is then perceived and defined in that way. And there's an interesting parallel with quantum physics, and I suppose the whole interaction between an event and the observer actually affecting the experiment itself. And I often wonder whether both UFOs, alien abductions, and perhaps all manner of other strange phenomena might be explained in a way more akin to quantum physics. Well, I've often been asked about the Men in Black, and on one occasion I remember being asked, and the audience began, there was a sort of murmur and then outright laughter, and I realised that in the middle of a denial of this, I was stood up wearing a black suit, and indeed, of course, I'm wearing a black jacket now. But I think, undoubtedly, there have been occasions, of course, where government and military personnel have gone to visit UFO witnesses as part of the normal investigative process. We don't tend to do it now, but it certainly happened in the past. And particularly during the days of the Cold War, I think it's quite possible that a conversation was ended with a phrase such as, probably best not to talk about that. For I think fairly understandable reasons, more to do with it just being the sign of the times. Just the default position back in the days of the Cold War was not to discuss anything to do with the government and the military and intelligence. I think there's a world of difference between that and suggesting that there's some sort of agency going around silencing UFO witnesses and researchers. I mean, actually, if there were, they're an extraordinary inept agency, because of course there are sort of TV programs, DVDs, radio shows, absolutely. So I don't hold much for that theory. I think there are potentially another couple of points worth mentioning. it's quite possible to me, it's well known that in the UFO research community, many of the individual researchers and groups hate each other and are in competition with each other. So it's quite possible that somebody perhaps gets a whiff of an interesting case and then goes and visits the witness and thinks, well, I'll pretend to be from the government and I might get some more information. It's possible that we're dealing with Walter Mitty type fantasists. It's well known and documented that there are people who dress up as police officers, as paramedics, and actually go to the lengths to get the correct uniforms, vehicles, etc. As part of a sort of fantasy. It's probably quite glamorous to portray yourself, if you're going to have that sort of Walter Mitty fantasy, as part of a sinister government conspiracy and group of people in charge of the truth about extraterrestrials and UFOs. It's also possible that some of the people who claim to have been visited by sinister men in black are simply not being truthful when they make those claims. So again, I don't think there's one neat answer. There may be a lot of different things going on. But I'm, despite the way I'm dressed, I'm not some sort of real man in black.
We just asked the question which leads on from that, which is what a lot of people want to know.
Yes, indeed.
You are wearing black, you've left the MOD, are you a stooge? No, it's a simple question.
It is, sure.
And you wanted to answer it.
Yeah, I want to answer it. Because it is a question.
It's your DVD, you've got to tell people.
It's all over the internet, so yeah, sure. Well, ever since I spoke out publicly about the UFO phenomenon, I've been accused by certain UFO researchers and conspiracy theorists of being a disinformation agent, being part of the cover-up, but being somehow put out as the friendly face designed to encourage UFO groups to send their reports to the government, designed to mislead people and plant false stories, etc., etc. Those stories first surfaced as soon as I spoke out. They haven't just started now I've left the MOD. In a sense, let me do what of course I can only do, deny them. It's simply not true. I'm not a disinformation agent, but I won't say much more than that because frankly there's no point. The sorts of people that believe I am are probably so wedded to the idea of a cover-up and a conspiracy that nothing I say is going to change their mind. I'm not going to deny it and then have them turn around and say, oh, all right then.
Because he's denying it.
The denial with those sorts of people is simply seen as reinforcement of their own belief system. So perhaps it says more about them than it says about me. But let me clarify why I did leave the MOD. I left simply because, having done 21 years working for the government, I just felt that it was time to move on. I've got a number of outside business interests and I just wanted to spend more time pursuing those business interests. I didn't leave because I had got too close to the truth. I wasn't forced out. I'm still very friendly with all sorts of former colleagues. I get invited back on a regular basis. Of course, some people say, oh, he hasn't really left at all. He's just sort of pretending that he has, but he's really still on the payroll and he's still gathering information, planting disinformation, etc., etc. No, I left. I had a tremendous time. I very much enjoyed my 21 years of government service. I've done some fascinating things, not just the UFO project, all sorts of other things, but it was simply time for something else, fresh challenges.
Have you ever met Scully Mulder?
I've never met. You mean the actors? I've never met David Duchovny or Gillian Anderson. I would particularly like to meet Gillian Anderson, and I have on several occasions expressed a desire to work with her on various projects. And no, I think, actually, joking aside, it would be a good in-joke, and I, honestly, I haven't got any ulterior motive for that whatsoever.